The Devonian period was home to the largest armored predator in Earth's history, a bone-plated scissor-jawed fish called Dunkleosteus. It ruled the ocean from 382 to 356 million years ago, and at the time it lived, was the biggest apex predator on the planet. Given its tremendous success on Earth, we have to ask the question, could this iconic plate armor carnivore survive in the alien oceans of Subnautica? And if so, how would the prehistoric apex integrate into the xenobiology of planet 4546b? We'll cover how it adapts to the environments of its new home, finds food to satiate its hunger, and confronts the hanger of predators and competitors. After that, we'll reinterpret Dunkleosteus as a spec-evo Subnautica creature, designing three different forms that could be added to the game. If this sounds interesting to you, you might enjoy the other episodes I've done in the series, as well as similar spec-evo scenarios I've done with prehistoric life. Let's dive in. Built like a sumo wrestler, Dunkleosteus was about the size of a great white shark, at up to 4 meters or 13.5 feet long and weighing about 1,500 kilograms for the largest specimens. It was stocky and short, with a stiffened trunk to transmit force to its long tail. Dunkleosteus would have been a fast swimmer as a result, and could use its bony extensions in the jaw to shear prey in half. Recent research indicates that previous claims about its jaw closing speed may have been exaggerated, which would also mean that its bite force needs to be reevaluated, but considering it was hunting other armored fish, I don't imagine that it was biting down with anything less than bone-crushing power. That new study found that the dunk could open its jaws 65 to 70 degrees, giving it a menacing gape and letting it bite into fairly large prey. It likely lived as an open-water apex predator, using high bursts of speed to attack other placoderms from behind and rip them into pieces. A 2010 paper found that the depth of Dunkleosteus's original environment ranged from 30 to 100 meters below the surface, giving us a good estimate for the biomes in Subnautica it will naturally gravitate towards. The safe shallows is absolutely one of those biomes, with a depth range of 0 to 80 meters. There are plenty of small fish in the water column where Dunkleosteus would be perfectly comfortable chasing them down, and it's likely more than fast enough to do so. Bladderfish are tough and gristly, but commonplace. Peepers provide more calories even if they're slightly harder to catch. Boomerangs are great, large, and easy to bite in half. Garyfish are another option if perhaps less optimal. Gastropods are close to the size of Dunkleosteus and produce noxious clouds when attacked, making them less than ideal. The dunk population would learn quickly to avoid them, instead darting above the coral in tunnels and chomping down on smaller fish. It's hard to imagine a better biome for the dunks introduced to planet 4546b. Although plopping a breeding population in the safe shallows would make them notably less safe for the player. Let's keep exploring to see if we find something even better. Quick aside, the vast majority of people who watch these videos aren't subscribed. I'd appreciate if you would subscribe to let me know that you want more Thrive or Eaten Alive videos, or if there's something else you'd like to see, please comment. Now back to the video. The kelp forest is much deeper, ranging from 90 to 170 meters below the surface. That's near the limit of where Dunkleosteus is believed to have hunted in its native environment, but the lack of preserved soft tissue makes it difficult to precisely examine any adaptations for deeper water that the armored fish may have had in life. The food, however, is quite tempting. Bleeders, as annoying as they are to humans, wouldn't be able to do much against a Dunkleosteus and its inch-thick armor. Boomerangs make a welcome return. Eye-eyes, hoopfish, hoverfish, and rabbit rays are newcomers, most of which are slow and large enough to be on the menu for a 3,000-pound speedy hunter. Apart from the depth, the only potential issue is the stalker. A resident apex predator similar in length to the Dunkleosteus, although admittedly much lighter and lacking armor. Stalkers collect scrap metal and eat the fish here. They're very slow, however, and don't have the biting power to pierce the Dunkleosteus armor or the durability to resist their attacks. Our Devonian friend would likely outcompete the stalkers or even eat them, at least in the more shallow areas of the kelp forest. But there is more to explore. The mushroom forest, specifically the one in the northwest section of the crater, is 75 to 250 meters deep, so the shallow regions overlap with Dunkleosteus' range. The armored carnivore could rule the water above the mushrooms as well as hunt in the upper areas, taking down spadefish and peepers. Jelly rays are found further down but are highly toxic. Bone sharks are a potential threat in the mushroom forest. They're deeper down than where Dunk would likely be living, however, and while they're a similar length, are much less muscular with a smaller bite. Perhaps they'd actually be on the menu if they interacted, given how wide of a gape Dunkleosteus had and how it was adapted for taking down other armored fish. Let's put a pin in that idea. The grassy plateaus are where things get interesting. At 40 to 200 meters deep, these plains carpeted in blood grass provide a wide open area that would be great for Dunkleosteus to swim around in. They're close by the safe shallows and would be a natural choice for expansion, even coming with a great menu. Biters, despite their aggression, become popcorn. Boomerangs are high calorie and slow. Hoopfish, peepers, and spadefish are all familiar and delicious, with Reginald's providing yet another juicy meal option. Reefback leviathans are gentle giants, but covered in armor that puts even the dunks to shame. Not to mention they're twice the size of a blue whale. Definitely not an option. Sand sharks are the reason that the plateaus are an interesting place for Dunkleosteus to hang out. They're essentially the native equivalent morphologically. Sand sharks are thick, wide-jawed, armored carnivorous fish, about 3 meters long, or the same size as a small Dunkleosteus. The difference between the two, and the reason why they won't overlap, is that sand sharks focus on, well, the sand. They shove themselves through the sea floor, scaring up prey that they can leap out towards and attack. They rarely go more than 20 feet above the bottom, and so would be hunting in a totally different niche. We could have two morphologically similar predators in this biome, almost identical in size, hunting in completely different levels of the water column. Ocean ecology is wild. The underwater islands expand our horizons, vertically as well as horizontally. From 25 to 500 meters deep, they form a huge biome of open water interspersed with floating chunks of rock. Reefback leviathans roam here and there, sometimes as large as the islands themselves. Boomerangs, garyfish, hoopfish, peepers, and spadefish provide a reason for the Dunkleosteus to enter the biome, apart from the open water that it would already love. Bone sharks operate here as well, and as previously discussed, would likely lose out to dunks in areas where they overlap. We could see a stratigraphic difference, where the bone sharks eat in lower levels of the water, while the invasive placoderm takes the shallow regions of the biome. Either way, this place feels fairly similar to home, and certainly has enough food to be worth staying in long term. The crag field, however, is not as ideal. Some areas are certainly shallow enough, with a depth of 45 to 560 meters, but the food just isn't as good on this cruise line compared to other biomes the dunk population has already spread to. Boomerangs and Reginalds are good, but hoopfish are small and fast, shuttlebugs are tiny, and Mesmer's hypnotic abilities only cause problems. Reefback leviathans are not even a thought. Bone sharks may again be edible, but tend to crowd the deeper areas of the biome and would be targeting the same prey. It's not that the crag field is terrible, it just isn't good either. The mountains would be pretty solid, with biters, hoopfish, boomerangs, peepers, and Reginalds as food sources, and a depth ranging from 0 to 560 meters. Ordinarily, the dunks would be able to patrol the shallows around the shores of the mountain island, snapping at the fish they'd find there. However, they're not the apex predator here, and it's not really debatable. 7 Reaper leviathans patrol these waters, each one 55 meters long and weighing hundreds of tons. They use their roars to find prey and then grab them with powerful mandibles, stabbing and gripping victims before tearing them to pieces with huge jaws. Their willingness to attack even human-sized animals and bite through solid metal means that even Dunkleosteus wouldn't be safe. The dunes, as I'm sure you're all aware by now if you've seen previous episodes of this series, are even worse. Take the mountains, lower the food diversity, and add another Reaper leviathan. Not a chance, Dunk. Sorry. Biomes that are far too deep for the Dunkleosteus to likely seek out include the Bulb Zone, the Sea Treader's Path, the Grand Reef, and the Blood Kelp Zone. Out of the biomes we did visit, I'd argue that the safe shallows and grassy plateaus are most suitable for an open water, fast, mid-sized predator. They have lots of food, plenty of space, and minimal competition, providing great places for the alien placoderm to create a foothold on 4546b. Overall, Dunkleosteus earns a 7 out of 10 for its home score. There weren't too many biomes that it would be pre-adapted to, but the few it does well in, it totally dominates. For hunger, we're looking at an 8. Subnautica offers tons of small to medium prey items that are easy enough to catch, and most of them are relatively defenseless. Dunkleosteus was fast, and given its adaptations for slicing through armor, wouldn't have trouble with the vast majority of native prey animals. And hanger? The two most notable competitors are sand sharks and bone sharks, both of which are about the same length as a Dunkleosteus, but much less powerful. Dunkleosteus has strong enough jaws and a wide enough gape that it may even be able to turn some of its competitors into meals, and its adaptations for speed means it might reach its food before the native hunters do. It is not, however, going to tangle with a Reaper leviathan, but prefers to stay in shallow biomes anyway, where it's less likely to encounter such monstrosities. That's another 8. Dunkleosteus Terralai gets a Thrive or Eaten Alive score of 7.33. Quite good, actually. It's nice not to be working with a supergiant apex predator because it lets you explore niches and environments that are a little bit out of the way. Dunkleosteus succeeds here because of its speed, armor, and the role it filled on Earth, an open-water, armor-crushing predator that specializes in the shallows. If I'm being entirely honest, a speculative evolution section wouldn't even be necessary here. It's already perfectly capable of becoming a permanent mainstay of the grassy plateaus and safe shallows without needing to undergo significant changes. However, I know you all would lynch me if I forewent that section, so let's talk about how to integrate Dunkleosteus terrali into the game. Rebranded Dunk in 3, 2, 1. The axe tooth represents a descendant of our current scientific understanding of Dunkleosteus, adapted for Subnautica. It's a fast, armored carnivore, about 6 meters long and weighing 2 tons. It retained a similar body shape to its ancestor, but is slightly less robust, leaning into a thuniform build to increase its speed. Its jaw muscles shifted and elongated, increasing its gape to nearly 80 degrees to allow capture of larger prey. The axe tooth is a predator specialized for hunting bone sharks. You can find them in the mushroom forests and underwater islands especially, as its more elongate build is better adapted for deeper water than the original Dunkleosteus. They track their victims and then use their incredible speed to rush from behind, opening their wide jaws and biting down with tremendous force to sever bone sharks in half. Luckily, they live alone, and typically don't demonstrate too much interest in humans or smaller animals. The dune gape is based on the recently outdated Dunkleosteus hunting technique of suction feeding. Despite its name, the dune gape does not actually live in the dunes proper. It's a squat, wide ambush predator living in the grassy plateaus, hiding under the sand. An abnormally high density of fast-twitch muscle fibers, combined with it foregoing the heavy, thick armor its ancestor was known for, have made it into a devastatingly fast, camouflaged hunter. Its jaw structure has changed, forming a huge O shape that generates powerful suction when opened. Powerful enough to drag a sand shark into its mouth in 20 milliseconds, faster than a human eye can blink. To adequately prey upon sand sharks with suction feeding, the dune gape needs to be big. And it is. At 13 meters long and 8 tons, it's the largest carnivore in the grassy plateaus by a large margin. It will also use its suction feeding ability to take in groups of smaller fish as they pass by, but it prefers to eat sand sharks. Why? We're not quite sure, but it seems personal. The Death Angler Leviathan represents Subnautica's take on the Dunkleosteus of 20 years ago, a huge, armored behemoth rising up from the depths to crush prey into ribbons. Native to the blood kelp zone and bulb zone, the Death Angler Leviathan is 40 meters long and weighs 250 tons. Its plate armor is also insulated with thick fat layers, allowing it to resist the natural weapons of its prey, ampules. Death anglers possess a bioluminescent ability that mimics ampules' mating signals, luring them down into the depths of their respective zones. They then use their powerful tails to launch an attack, slicing the 20-meter armored eels into sashimi and devouring them, leaving nothing behind. Death anglers retain the armor not only as a defense against bioelectric attacks, but also against each other, as they will fight over food when resources are scarce. They tend not to attack sea moths or prawn suits, but will immediately attack cyclops submersibles within their line of sight. Protective measures are recommended. I wasn't planning on making a mega kaiju variant for this video. I think it's important that not every animal we throw into Subnautica has some giant version, since smaller scale ecology is also really interesting. But then I remembered a certain 1984 monster movie that was a huge part of my childhood, and I couldn't resist throwing a Dunkleosteus Kraken hybrid designed to horrify Subnautica players. Say hello to the Devilfish Leviathan, an unholy titan that represents the worst that the ocean has to offer, and not coincidentally bears a resemblance to the sea dragon leviathans. It dwells in the Carnage Trench, a previously undiscovered megabiome on the ocean planet where life is twisted and chaotic, and the lines between the void and the biome are blurred. Devilfish leviathans, including their posterior tentacles, are typically a kilometer long. Their jaws are wicked and sharp, perfect for slicing through abnormally large ghost leviathans, Ragnarok leviathans, and young gargantuans in deep famines, and processing their carcasses. Females have wide membranes between their tentacles to facilitate egg storage, while the males possess simple tentacles. Thankfully, they stick fairly close to the Carnage Trench, only emerging during hunts. All recent observations of these monsters have been from miles away, since they seem to have a preference for attacking human vessels. We would study this behavior further in depth, but staying alive remains a high priority. Thank you for watching. I love making these videos, and I hope you enjoyed this latest installment. I suggest checking out the rest of the paleontology and speculative evolution projects on the channel, and please subscribe to let me know you enjoy this type of video. If you do like EcoSwap-style projects, you'll likely get a kick out of Extinction Obsidian Dawn, the first novel in my new epic fantasy trilogy. Think Aztecs versus Ancient Carthage, but both sides have psychic dinosaurs. You may also consider donating to the Dinos vs. Cancer fundraiser, which runs until December 14th, 2025. We're trying to reach $3,000 by then, and we're two-thirds of the way there as of this video's recording. Every little bit helps. Thank you again for being a part of the channel, and Merry Christmas! I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you the next time a prehistoric marine animal decides to vacation on an alien planet.